Welcome back to the Rome Empire Rules Today, disc number two. Now, if you don't have this disc, number one, see if you can't get it and watch it first. And then the second disc we're going to get into is going to shed tremendous amount of light that I did not share with you on the first disc. The Catholic Church picked up where Rome left off, where Nero of ancient Rome crucified Peter upside down for his Christian beliefs, and also the Holy Roman Empire, or the Catholic Church, Inquisition people who read the Bible or did not follow the doctrines of their church. And here you see the Inquisition going on, of the burning of the feet. This looks like what we carry in the Olympics. The flame represents the sun Baal, which we'll get into more. This looks like a stocking we hang on our Christmas, right above our fireplace at Christmas time. Here again, you see they're drowning this guy in water. They fill his lungs up full of water as a form of torture. And as we scan across the page here, we'll see there's a crucifixion of Christ right here, because they worship death, and that's why they always depict Christ on a cross, is because they worship his death, not his resurrection or life. And that's why every time you see the Christ on a cross, you know what the real meaning is the Inquisition of all those who oppose the Roman Empire today. This is the pay scale of the archbishop right here. The Catholic archbishop paid the high executioner. And here you see what they were paid for tearing apart and quartering by four horses. We can say that R represents dollars to make it simple. Yeah, you know, it's up here, the dollars and cents. But you can see here the tearing apart of quartering by four horsemen, the beheading as you cruise down, the burning alive, for breaking alive on the wheel, just on and on, all the different inquisitions that they were, the executioners were paid. And you can see all the different things, for beheading and sticking the head on a pole, you got paid 3.26. And so you can see how disgusting this whole thing is. Here's a Protestant. Here you can see a man being four-quartered for not reading this, for having the scriptures and reading it. And you can see nothing has changed over history. There's a close-up of Christ being where they worship death and not life. Here's the Pope. He always carries his staff with him all the time. On Sunday, the Catholics did not want to kill their subjects by torturing them. They wanted to keep them alive just enough so they can burn them on Sunday. And all Catholics had to attend, and if not, they were considered a heretic, and they were also Inquisition. Now we're going to fast forward it today, and nothing has changed. We have the Holocaust, and we'll get into the Inquisitions that's going on all the way up till the present. Where did the word Holocaust derive from? Well, let's see here. In the Catholic Bible, this is what it says in Numbers chapter 29. And ye shall offer a holocaust. And if you look at the King James Version or any other Bible translation version, they all say, and ye shall offer a burnt offering. And so, as we look at Norm William Davis Jr., he points out that studying together, him and his Catholic friend, we found that the word Holocaust was used more than 150 times in the Catholic Bible, but never once in the King James or any other Bible translation. He says, Noah Webster, the great linguist, scholar, who first gave us his famous dictionary in 1828, also published a very good translation of the Bible. He did not use the word Holocaust for burnt offering. Holocaust is a strange word used by both Christians and Jews describing what they characterize as Germany's final solution to the Jewish questions. Yet Holocaust has neither a Hebrew, Yiddish, German, or English origin, and its word that has a Greek origin, meaning to be burnt whole. How that Greek word managed to get into the Hebrew translation of the Catholic Bible, I can only speculate. So here they're trying to understand where this word even, how they even got it from the translation of the different languages, and they can't figure that out. But as you go on to read down here in 2 Kings 23:10, the Bible uses the phrase passing through the fire of Moloch. This is the Holocaust that is an abomination, but is still a burnt offering to the God, to a God. Remember, regardless of whether the burnt offering is to the Almighty God or whether the Holocaust is for pleasure of the pagan god Moloch, it is a sacrifice. Holocausts are sacrifices. A burnt offering to Almighty God done by Israel was the sweet smell of cattle and sheep consumed on the altar. The Holocaust of the seed of the serpent was always the sacrifice of their own children, making them pass through the fire. Holocaust to Moloch. And so you can see that it also goes to what they do today at the Bohemian Grove in Northern California. If you haven't seen that tape, you need to see that also. This is in Numbers 29, and you can see the word Holocaust is used 150 times throughout the Catholic Bible. And you notice the Catholic Bible came out before the King James Version of the Bible, and nobody wanted the Catholic Bible for the fact that they knew that at one time you were killed for reading the Bible. So none of the Protestants even wanted to have anything to do with the Catholics' version of their version of the Bible. There's the word Holocaust, one example. It's interesting to note in their Catholic Bible here in chapter 17 of Revelations, in their footnotes, it says the great city is Rome, and then it goes on, it says Babylon is a symbolic name of Rome. Is geographically described as the great harlot, and here they are admitting that they are the great harlot. And then here it says the seven hills of Rome, and if you cruise down a little bit, look at this, pretty fascinating. It says the beast is Nero, revived Nero, the beast, Rome to what? To regain power. Rome to regain power. And then as you go on here, check this out. At the end of the footnotes here, it says, not to, oh, it's right here, let's go. And then it says, against the harlot Rome, the great city. And then here is not to be taken literally. I thought that was interesting. Here they describe that they're the great harlot that's spoken of in Revelation 17. And then they come down here and say, is not to be taken literally. Isn't that something? For those that don't know, the New American Bible is the Catholic version of the Bible. Now I'm going to prove to you that this symbol right here is not a Christian symbol, but it is a symbol of Baal. And I will show you that. Of course, I'll show you on his hat is a symbol of Babylon. And here the cross, which they call the Christian cross, is nothing but a symbol of Babylon. Here is more symbolism on the Pope's uniform, symbol of Babylon. Of course, they call that the Iron Cross or the Maltese Cross, but it's a symbol of the sun god Baal. Even in the Egyptian tombstones, before Christ came along, or Christianity, they had the symbols of Baal, the sun cross. Here it is right here. And here in Newsweek, Business Week, it says the Ankh, the god of Egypt, has been transformed into a Christian cross. Now we're going to dig and find out where that goes back to Babylon. This is the proof where this iron cross is not Christian, but it goes back to Babylon. And this is where it came from right here. Let me scroll down. Right here's the proof. It's a Babylonian plow. Right here, it's from the Museum of the University of Pennsylvania. And it's a gang of men plowing and sowing, and from a Babylonian seal impression of the 14th century B.C. And so this is the proof right here, that if you look up, there's the farmers plowing, and here you see, as clear as day, is there's the symbol of the sun, symbol, S-U-N, the symbol of Babylon, Baal. And you can see it is worn by Adolf Hitler over his heart, the symbol of Baal. And there, all the Nazis and Germany at the time, this is the German mark of Germany. And you can see the symbols of the sun and Baal, the sun god. This is the symbols of the First Reich of the Holy Roman Empire. And there's the king's hat with the symbol of Babylon or Baal, the sun god. There's a symbol of Baal on the Second Reich flag. And here's the symbol of the Third Reich. And here you see the symbols of Baal, the sun god, on the Nazi flags. This is a 33rd degree medal that is worn by the 33rd degree Masons. And here you see the Baal symbol. And right here, we're gonna put this word that runs around the edge here and Google on the internet and find out what it says. And here you see order out of chaos, all in Latin. For those who have internet, the word that goes around this ring right here spells S-A-P-I-E-N-T-I-A. So S-A-P-I-E-N-T-I-A. And if you type that into Google, the search engine will take you to the Constitution of the Supreme Pontiff Pope. So here you see that the 33rd degree leads you to the Supreme Constitution of the Pontiff Pope. And you can do that on your internet. Just go to Google, type in that word, and you can see the direct connection through Freemasonry up through the Pope. And here you can see on their emblem is the three-finger salute, and right there is the guard that swears to protect the Pope, the Swiss Guard at the Vatican, is doing the three-finger salute as an oath of office to protect the Pope, and that represents the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost type three-finger salute. And here you see you got the York Rite and you have the Scottish Rite. And you see as you climb the ladder on both sides, you have the Order of the Red Cross, the Order of the Knights of Malta, the Order of the Knights Templar, and so you see these are all Catholic levels as you go up to the 33rd degree. And here you got the Scottish Rite, and look at this. The Grand Pontiff is a level. That's the Pope's office. The Knights, anytime there's a Knight, I will show you. The Knights means ancient Rome. Look at this, the Knights of the Sun, S-U-N. So each one of each parcel here goes right up to the 33rd degree, which is if you follow it up, you'll see right here, there's the emblem of the 33rd degree. That leads you right to the Supreme Pontiff Pope Constitution. Here's the symbol of Babylon. Here we, the official United States Army gives the Iron Cross, this one here, to the marksman shooting badge. This one you get for U.S. Army sharpshooter badge. And here is the expert shooting badge. And as you can see, here's the wreath of the olive branch. It's like when you win a race in the Olympics, they put the olive branch around your head. So here is a symbol of the olive branch around the sun symbol of Baal. Here's a statue of the first general of the Jesuits, Loyola, and his Inquisition skull. And here he is, and he's holding the Inquisition skull of the Protestants, of the Protestants. And this is found at the University Church in Seville, Spain. This is an article at a Time magazine, March 19, 2006, and the headline is Spanish Inquisition, Gibson Agrees, Mel Gibson. And it goes on and says, if he is so morbidly fascinated with the bloody deeds of the Jewish Pharisees and the Mayan priests, he doesn't hold a mirror to his own church and film the Spanish Inquisition. But Mel Gibson won't say that that's a future plan, but he nods and agrees that there are monsters in every culture. So isn't that interesting about the Inquisition of the Catholic Church? It's hid. In the scriptures it says, the woman and the beast that carrieth her, Revelation 17:7. And here you see on the European Union coin, the woman riding the beast. And in Revelation 17:1, the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. And here you see the European Union Parliament postage stamps issued in 1984. Here you have the woman, which we understand is the whore, and she's riding the beast upon the many waters, and there's the fish. So they're so blunt, they just stick this right on their postage stamps and on their money. And as you cruise down a little bit further here, you can also see this is the European Union office, and they got the whore riding the beast, a statue outside the European Union office in Brussels, and the woman riding the beast. Here's Time magazine, February 24th, 1992, and the cover story is The Holy Alliance, and you got Reagan and the Pope. And it says how Reagan and the Pope conspired to assist Poland's Solidarity movement and hasten the demise of communism. And the article goes on and it says, look what happened out of this secret agreement that they kept secret from the American people and the world. And look what happened when they had their secret meeting. They both brought down the Berlin Wall, ended the Cold War, and completely unraveled Soviet communism. And here you can see, anytime we get in bed with the Holy Roman Empire, things happen. For those that don't know, we now have a Roman Catholic majority on our Supreme Court as of February 2006. You can go to chick.com. And most people are not aware of the Catholics have been taken over our high offices. Of course, Ronald Reagan, when he did the secret deal with the popes, the Knights honor Reagan. And this is out of the New York Times, January 3rd, 1989. And it says here, the Sovereign Military Hospitaller Order of St. John's, Jerusalem, and Rhodes of Malta, Knights of Malta, presented the Grand Cross of Merit Special Class to President Reagan. And it says here that Mr. Reagan will be the first American president so honored. The first American, that's very important. Once we get into the Lincoln assassination and see what happened, the true story behind that. And here's the front cover of Time magazine, The Holy Alliance. Inside the Time magazine, it says Ronald Reagan and John Paul II, the Pope, secretly joined forces. Inside this Time magazine article, Alexander Haig said this in Time magazine, the Vatican's information was absolutely better and quicker than ours in every respect. Here we're the ones that have spent all this money for Echelon and everything with the satellites and so forth, but the Vatican has better intelligence than America. This is during the Cold War. How is that? And this revealing article continues to say, listen to the Holy Father. We have 2,000 years of experience at this. Yeah, persecuting the saints and anybody didn't go along with them ever since the Roman Empire through the Inquisition years of the Holy Roman Catholic Church up to this time. Sure, they got lots of experience. So we need to listen to our Holy Roman Empire, the Holy See. This is Time Magazine, September 16th, 1957, and here you have a quote right underneath the Black Pope. It says, "Would John Adams still cry damnation?" And as you can see this article, there's the Black Pope at that time in 1957. Then you read down here what John Adams says. John Adams, the founding father, says, If ever there was a body of men who merit eternal damnation on earth and in hell, it is this society of loyalists." And there you go. The founding fathers knew who the enemies of America were. This is a book by Thomas Paine called Common Sense. And on page 33, he says this, "But Britain is the parent company, say some. But it happens not to be true, or only partly so. And the phrase, parent or mother country, hath been jesuitically adopted by the king and his parasites with a low papistolical design of gaining an unfair bias on the credulous weakness of our minds. Europe and not England is the parent country of America." This is out of Thomas Paine's book, Common Sense, page 33. He says here it's been a jesuitically adopted by the king and his parasites with a low papistolical design of gaining unfair power. Again, he says it's Europe and not England that is the parent country of America. So it's basically the popes and his Jesuit power that's gained control of America. On page 31 of the same book, Thomas Paine goes on to say, "Politics is struck. A new method of thinking hath arisen. All plans, proposals, etc., prior to the 19th of April, is to the commencements of hostilities." Now we're going to find out what the April 19th is all about. Why is April 19th so important? Look what happened on April 19th, 1993. We had Waco. April 19th, 1995, we had Oklahoma City bombing. Let's go on to see what else has happened. President Franklin D. Roosevelt, right here, announced the United States will be abandoning the gold standard. Look what else happened on April 19th. We had the American Civil War. In 1775, we had the American Revolutionary War. What is so important about April 19th? And then we go right up here, and here we find out April 19th is the beginning of Protestantism, our Protestant movement. And it all started by Martin Luther, Martin Luther. And here you go on to say, in 1529, at the Diet of Speyer, a group of rulers, Germany, and independent cities of Germany, protested reinstatement of the Edict of Worms, and this was born the beginning of the Protestant movement. And so, look what happened on April 19th. April 19th is the beginning of the Protestant or Protestant movement against the Catholic Church. Now you know why April 19th is so important. So out of that, we have the American Revolutionary War, the American Civil War, we have the abandoning of the gold standard by Roosevelt, Waco, Oklahoma bombing, and look what happened in 2005 here. We had Joseph Ratzinger, the current Pope, who was elected Pope on April 19th. And then look at this. Easter Sunday falls on April 19th more often than any other date. And you can find this from Wikipedia Encyclopedia Online. This is a really interesting article here in the AP, March 14th, 2007. Here you have the Russian President Putin meeting with Santa Claus. He's the Pope, the current Pope, Benedict. Anyway, look what the article goes on to say. It says, Benedict wished Putin a warm welcome to the Vatican in the Pope's native language, the language of their talks. I didn't know Putin and the Pope spoke native language. German was their native language. They spoke to one another. It's interesting how it all comes together. I'm going to show you a few things out of this book called Hitler's Pope. Inside the book, this is a photograph of the signing of the Third Reich. And right here in the center of the picture is the man who spurred on the Third Reich, the signing of the agreement, the concordat between the Catholic Roman Church to govern over Germany. That's what the Reich is. His name is Perselles. He presides over the signing of the Reich Concordat at the Vatican on July 20th, 1933. Okay, this is really big. Pay attention to this. This is Percelli right here on his coordination day, March 12, 1939, on the eve of World War II. And look at this. Here he is being inaugurated as Pope on the eve of World War II. And the next day he has the Holy Crusades against Europe. And so he's the one who signed the Third Reich and who spurred it on. And then years later, 1939, on the eve of World War II, he starts the Holy Roman Crusades once again. Pope Leo the 12th had the above medal minted in 1825. And as you can see here on the back of the medal here, this word that reads around the block, Sedet Super Universalum, declaring her seat of authority is universal over the entire globe. And here he is sitting on the globe. She's sitting there. And here she has the sun and the bell sun symbol. And here she's holding the golden cup in her hand, just like in Revelation 17 talks about. Okay, pay attention to this. This is very important. The Pope had two special forces, the Knights Templar that was formed in 1118 and the Knights Hospitallers that was formed in 1113. Now this is out of the dictionary. It goes on to say the Knights Templar was suppressed in 1312. We'll get into more into that. But look at the second definition, a man belonging to the Masonic order in the United States. Right out of the dictionary. You don't have to look very hard to see where the Freemasonry comes from. Okay, when the Knights Templar were suppressed in 1312, the Knights Templar, they wore a red cross on a white brown, on a white background until they were disbanded and their property and wealth passed to the Knights Hospitallers. Okay, this is out of the New Catholic Dictionary, and it says the Knights Templar is known today as the Knights of Malta. Thus we have the Maltese Cross right here. The Iron Cross and the Maltese Cross are the cross of Babylon, of Baal the sun god. So if you go on and read in the Catholic Dictionary, it says here the Knights Hospitallers is known now as the Knights of Malta. They changed their names, and the Knights Hospitaller changed their names to the Knights of Rhodes, Rhodes Scholar, sounds familiar. And then they changed their name again in the 1530s as the Knights of Malta. And this is where the Black Pope meets with the Knights of Malta that controls all the corporations of the world, the international banking of the world, and all the secret societies branch down from there. Okay, when the Knights Templar, their logo was a red cross on a white background. Does that look familiar? Red cross on a white background, American Red Cross. And then if you go on and read, the Knights Hospitallers controlled the hospital system. Where do you think the word hospital came from? So here you see that all along, the American Red Cross, the hospital system, is named after the Knights Hospitallers. And of course, they were the ones who took care of the injured and the sick. And of course, who's the most important person in the military is the medic. You always protect him. And so here, around 1113, Pope Paschal II acknowledged the hospitaller as a religious order. So even the hospital system, the American Red Cross, you can see the symbol here of Baal. You can see it all leads back to Rome, or leads back to Babylon. This is on December 1st, 2006, and this is the new Mexican president. He takes the Roman oath of office, and as you see in my first video, I get into that in the encyclopedia. That's not the Hitler salute, that's the Roman salute. And as you can see, his competitor, he lost by 1%, also is doing the Roman salute. And here you see in the background, this is the official mascot of ancient Rome, was the eagle. This is out of Fox News, and this is December 20th, 2006, and the headline is, Jesus Christ to be Honorary King of Poland. And it goes on, Poland, lawmakers have drawn up a resolution naming Jesus Christ as the Honorary King of Poland, but have failed to win support from the country's powerful Roman Catholic Church. Isn't that interesting? This is very interesting. You can't have Jesus Christ as your king in European Union, but you can have the Pope's statue goes up in France despite protests, November 28, 2006. Here you see the Pope's statue in bronze, even though the people, 500, marched to not have this statue go up because French law says separating church from the state. And I put not, It's kind of interesting that you can't have Jesus Christ as your king, but you can have the Pope statue put up in France. This is out of December 23rd, 2006. Bono to receive honorary knighthood. The Irish rocker is going to receive the knighthood honor. So the scriptures say that everything leads back to Babylon. So here in CNN, February 13, 2002, says Giuliani joins a distinguished club. Says England, when Rudolph Giuliani receives his honorary knighthood from Queen Elizabeth II on Wednesday, he joined an exclusive club with membership dating back to what? Ancient Rome. What doesn't lead back to Rome? So now whenever you hear the word knighthood, now it tells you where the roots come from is ancient Rome. This is very key right here. Pay attention. Dagon, their Babylonian god. If you read Judges in the Old Testament, chapter 16, verse 23, and it says, "And the lords of the Philistines gather them together to offer a great sacrifice unto Dagon, their god." And so what I did is I went down to the Webster Dictionary, and it says, what's the definition? Dagon, little fish. Dagon equals a fish. The fish god, the national god of the Philistines. This idol had a body of a fish with the head and hands of a man. It was an Assyro-Babylonian deity. So now we know that that's a Babylonian deity. So if we go up here, we can see here's the old Babylonian deity with the fish head. And here you see the Pope Benedict with his fish hat, showing you that he is the priest of Babylon. Here it is, walking in darkness and noonday. These symbols are right in our face. And here you see the priest of Babylon, like the scriptures to warn us about. Here you see the Pope wearing that represents Dagon, the Babylonian deity. This is at November 11th, 2006, Kissinger, Pope's advisor. Isn't that interesting that all these New World Order characters are all linked with the Pope? This is the Capitol building at Washington, D.C. And I also wanted to look up the word capital, what that word actually means. And also each state has this capital, which looks like a woman's boob here. And we'll look that word up now. So this is what it says as out of the Webster Dictionary. I looked up the word capital, and it's Latin for capitulum. The Temple of Jupiter. Now, Jupiter was the ancient god of ancient Rome. The Temple of Jupiter. Isn't that interesting? At Rome on the Capitoline Hill. And this is right out of the Webster Dictionary. A building in which a state legislator body meets, the building in which the functions of state government are carried out, and the building at which the United States Congress meets in Washington. So I looked up the word Capitoline Hill. It's the highest of the seven hills of Rome. The English word capital derives from Capitoline Hill. And this is right in the scriptures. If you read, it says that this Roman church sits on the seven hills. And on top of the seven hills is the capital, which represents the temple of Jupiter, the ancient god of ancient Rome. Isn't that fascinating? Interesting to note, the temple of Jupiter's. Here you got Vatican Rome, and you got Washington, D.C., the headquarter buildings mirror each other. Here you got the Capitol, and you got the obelisk Nimrod, which is Nimrod is Baal, the obelisk, and the front is male, and you got female in the background. And it's interesting that both Vatican Rome and Washington, D.C. mirror each other. So now I had to look up the word pontiff. That's another name for the Pope. And if you look at the ancient Roman Pontifex Maximus, and it ties with the modern Roman Pontifex Maximus, and you go down here to the encyclopedia, and you see here that the Pontifex Maximus were held by the different Caesars from 1533 of ancient Rome all the way up to Caesar in 12 BC. And then in this encyclopedia says, then it was held by Pope Gregory the First to the present, held by the popes. And so you hear ancient Rome of Pontifex Maximus with modern. And so here you got pontiff, short for pontifex. I like this quote, "The beginning of wisdom is the admission of ignorance." And here you see the signing of the Third Reich. Very few people ask what the First Reich is or the Second Reich. And anyway, I looked up the word concordant because that's what they signed. And so I looked up in the dictionary under concordant, And this is what it says, an agreement between the Pope and a government. So I looked up the encyclopedia under and looked up concordant in the encyclopedia, and this is what it says. An agreement specifically between the Pope and the temporal authority of the state. A contract between church and state. There you go. Now you know why the founding fathers said that they did not want to have church and state, because they saw what happened in Europe all those years with the Roman Catholic Church in bed with the European kings. This is interesting out of an old history book. Here it looks like the Nazis are having a prayer circle and the three fingers salute, and you see the prayer circles are having and initiating the new troops. And of course, what are they swearing allegiance to? They're swearing allegiance to the Reich, which is the Holy Roman Empire, which is a contract between church and state, making the Catholic Church the government of God of that state. It's very interesting out of that same history book. Here you see the people wait in food lines. And I thought I'd read this to you because this is fascinating. It says, in 100,000 Reichsmarks, which 2 months previously would have bought a house, 2 months later, it could buy a loaf of bread. So that's why Brigham Young and everybody says, get your food storage, get it now, because one day a loaf of bread will be able to buy you a house. Just flipping through the news, this didn't surprise me. The Roman Catholic mayor of Bethlehem. So isn't it interesting, as you start doing some digging, you find out that mayors and people in high positions of government around the world are Roman Catholic. This is Coronado Naval Base in San Diego, United States. And here, this is Google. You can find out for yourself. Go on the internet and blow this picture up. And right on the U.S. Naval Base, you have a SWAT sticker or the symbol of Babylon from the sky. Isn't that very interesting? Yeah, I picked this up at the gun show. There was these veterans of foreign wars of the United States, and you can see all along who they've been fighting for. Of course, it's Rome. They've been fighting for the Roman Empire. Also, it goes back to Babylon, because there's a Babylon sun symbol. I don't know, once you're aware of what's going on, look at your credit cards. The American Express business, and look who they have here. They have a Roman soldier on your American Express credit card. So just look around, you can see the symbols of Rome everywhere. Now we're going to back up into history and find out who really killed President Abraham Lincoln, who assassinated him. And so I'll show you a few photographs here. This is the book that has the trials of Abraham Lincoln in it, that's basically suppressed from the public because the Jesuits do not want you to read true history of who was behind the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. Inside the book, this is the man here who wrote the book. This is the general who sat on the military commission that trialed and executed 8 of Abraham Lincoln's assassination people. And he's standing right here. As you flip the book right here, you can see his name is Thomas M. Harris. He's a brigadier general, and the book was written in 1897. And so this book was heavily suppressed, and it's recommended reading. When the Jesuits take an oath of office, they swear to kill their enemies by the poisonous cup or by the laden bullet. And if you look at all the presidents of the United States, they were all either killed by the poisonous cup or the laden bullet. And here's the first president that was assassinated. It was President Henry Harris in 1841. And here you got President Zachary Taylor. He was also poisoned and killed in 1850. And then here are two presidents that were assassinated by the laden bullet. This one here is James Garfield in 1881. And also over here is President William McKinley in 1901. And of course, they assassinated Abraham Lincoln also by the laden bullet. So we flip the page over here, and you got this man here, James Buchanan, they were trying to poison him, because all of the men of the North drank tea and all the men of the South drank coffee. And so what they did is they poisoned him, all the tea, and then all the ones who drank tea, most of them died. So it says in 1857, February, President James Buchanan escaped a wholesale poisoning in which 50 were affected and 38 died. And so anyway, there's a great long history of poisonings and death. And Abraham Lincoln here was shot by the laden bullet, with JFK also was shot by the laden bullet. Here's a photograph of Ford's theater, and during the assassination, John Surratt, who was the Jesuit accomplice that got Booth to go in there to assassinate, stood outside and counted, and many of the witnesses witnessed John Surratt as John Booth entered into the building. And here you see inside depicting John Booth murdering Abraham Lincoln, jumped off the stage and ran. And what's interesting is when they finally caught up with John Booth, he had a Catholic medallion hung held in his hand as he clutched it when he was shot to death at a barn. But what's really interesting about John Surratt is they spent 18 months looking for him, and obviously they killed his mother because the mother was involved in the conspiracy, and used her house was the location of all these people who were secretly conspiring to kill Lincoln. Well, anyway, when they finally caught up with John Surratt, it took them 18 months to find him, and they had a $25,000 reward, dead or alive. And when they finally found this John Surratt, guess where he was? Here he is, John Harrison Surratt, in a papal uniform at the time of his arrest and return to the United States. Here's John Surratt in his Pope's uniform. He's the bodyguard of the Pope. Isn't that interesting? 18 months, they finally caught up with this character, and here he is as the Pope's personal bodyguard. And no wonder this history's been buried. All you have to do is read the trial of John Surratt that's in the government congressional papers. Again, this book is very important. It's all documented by that general that sat on the board of the trials. This book is called Rome's Responsibility for the Assassination of Abraham Lincoln by Thomas M. Harris, late Brigadier General. And this book is very important to read and understand true history. Very few people know the history of Croatia, how it was made into a state in 1941. But this book here talks about the whole history, and it's called The Vatican's Holocaust. And what happened was the Vatican wanted its own independent state, and so they formed a state out of Yugoslavia. They took the southern part and formed Croatia, and the Catholics killed one-third of the entire population of Croatia. Most of them were Eastern Orthodox, and you never hear this in your history books. They always say it's always the Jews, it's always the Jews. No, you need to read the history of Croatia. And this book is written by this man right here, and his name is Avro Manhattan, and he's a resident of London, and during World War II, he operated a radio station called Radio Freedom, broadcasting to occupied Europe. This man found out that the Vatican was behind World War II, behind Hitler, in fact, behind everyone, behind the banking, the international banking system, and he wrote like a dozen books or so talking about these atrocities and who is truly behind it all. This book is very heavily documented with pictures and documentation. Here you see a Catholic priest, and here he is changing uniform into Utashis is what they were called in Croatia. And when the Nazis swept through the Europe, it opened the window and the door for the Catholics to have the Utashis dress in their uniforms, have concentration camps and so forth to kill one-third of the entire population of Croatia. Here you see on page 68, the Catholic priest here is given all those souls wish not to be killed the option of either being baptized into the Catholic Church or being put to death. And here you see him baptizing those who do not want to be killed, so they will swear an allegiance to the Pope and Rome instead of death. These are the atrocities you see here in Croatia. And of course, they all want to talk about Germany, but they never want to talk about the Utashis and the Catholics killing all the Orthodox and all those who oppose the Catholic Church. Here they hold up as trophies, the Catholics held up the Protestants of the Catholic Church, or Protestants of the Catholic Church. And this guy's head is actually cut off, and he's holding the head on so he can have his trophy picture taken. Interesting to note, back in 1776, Adam Weishaupt, who founded the Illuminati, was a Jesuit at the Jesuit University in Germany. And what happened was he was Jewish, and they call him crypto Jews. Whenever a Jew swears his allegiance to Rome and gets baptized in Rome, if you look up that word crypto Jew, it tells you that's what the definition means, a Jew that swears an allegiance to Rome. Anyway, it's interesting that the Illuminati basically made sure that they blame the Jews for everything. That was part of their great secret, is that every time somebody would see everything that was after 1776, let's get this straight, none of the Jews had any power before 1776. All their power came after 1776, like the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, all those were established after 1776. Thus, everybody blames everything on the Jews. And this was the whole plan of Adam Weishaupt and the Illuminati, which is a branch of the Jesuits. And so just think about it. Everything that happened after 1776, the Jews are behind everything, so they can turn around and kill, blame the Jews and kill the Jews for everything. And that's the Lord's people, is the Jewish, the house of Israel, Judah, where the Jews derive from. Okay, here's the definition of crypto-Jew. It says crypto-Jew. The term crypto-Jew is also used to describe the descendants of the Jews who still generally secretly maintain some Jewish traditions, often while adhering to other faiths, most commonly Catholicism. And here you see, here the big word is secretly. It's called a crypto-Jew who's secretly adhering to Roman Catholicism, basically to Rome's doctrine. So here we see this is the Illuminati plan to get the Jews all persecuted, because they're actually, the Jews that are really running the show are actually working for Rome. This is Brandenburg Gate in Berlin, and this is a picture that was photographed May 8, 1945, showing the destruction of Berlin and Nazi Germany. This also became the Iron Wall, ran right through here. And here you see the European Union coin. And this is actually a 50-cent coin, European Union coin. And look, they have the same depiction of the Roman Empire. As you see, here's the four horsemen, like the four apocalypse of Revelations. You got like the white horse, you got the red horse, the pale horse, and the black horse. It's interesting, they got the four horsemen, and up on top they have the symbol of Baal with the Roman eagle up on top. It's all interesting how, when you understand symbolism, you can see all this. But it's interesting how they minted a coin right here depicting this is actually the symbol of division and reunification. And so here you see it was destroyed at one time, and now they're going to reunify Europe, the European Union, and build up the Fourth Reich, which the First, Second, Third Reich continue to try to build up this New World Order. Now we're entering into the Fourth Reich under the New World Order of the Roman Babylon Empire. This is another good book called Rulers of Evil, about Tupper Saucy. Anyway, he goes on to explain how the Jesuits were really into theater and entertainment, because they wanted the Protestants to get away from their Bible. In order to get away from their Bible reading and studying the scriptures all the time, they invented theater, and they brought in Shakespeare and other diversionaries to keep us from studying the Bible in school. And so now they realize that the people love entertainment, and so the Jesuits have always been into entertainment. And so basically they have used entertainment to get us away from our Bible studies in school, and now we study Shakespeare instead. And he also goes on to explain how before the United States Constitution was formed, the colonies under their constitution, if you were a Catholic, you could not vote or hold office, which is really important. And so that was one of the reasons the Jesuits have worked to help bring in the Constitution is a secret back door, but it's all into this book right here, The Rulers of Evil. The Catholic Church and the Jesuits have been out here for 300 years before Brigham Young and the Mormons came out here to Utah. And as you see here, they found gold with the Babylonian iron sun cross of Baal on them. And also, if you study the Uintas and the mines around here, you find out that the Jesuits have used the Indians and the Mexicans as slave to ore their gold out of America. And when the King of Spain, Carlos, the King of Spain, found out that the Jesuits were stealing the gold, then he had those Jesuits killed down in Mexico, the ones he could catch, and the rest of them fled out with their ships to Spain loaded with gold. And so for 300 years, you can see the history of that period of time that the Jesuits were in this area long before Brigham Young and the Mormons came out. On page 64 of this book, when King Carlos rounded up the Jesuits to get rid of them, they shut down, they forced closings of 133 missions, 24 colleges, 11 seminaries, plus large number of Indian schools. The Jesuits have always been into education, and you can see that they had a stronghold of education out here way back in the 1500s and 1600s on forward about educating the populace. And if you educate the population, you can control the way they think. Now we're going to fast forward it up till today, January 2007. The U.S. Catholic School Enrollment Update. Look, there is 8,000 Catholic schools in America, 6,785 elementary, 1,215 secondary schools, and there's 47 new schools that have opened. What other religious group? It's not the Jews. It's not any other group of entities that has opened this many schools. And yet, it's amazing that if you study the history of Catholics through the Middle Ages, all the way up through till today, you'll see that the Catholics have always been in charge of your school systems. And here's a news article, March 26, 2007, the ADL Vatican Jewish Relations. And here you see the director of the ADL receiving the highest award of, it's called the Papal Knighthood, the Papal Knight of the Order of Saint Gregory. It's the highest church honor that the director of the ADL has received. Most people believe the Jews are behind everything, but here shows that the Catholic Church has given the director of the ADL the highest award that any person could get, called the Papal Knighthood. And remember, knighthood represents ancient Rome, the membership of ancient Rome, Babylon. This is Nancy Pelosi, the new House Speaker of Congress, and here she is standing with a top Jesuit priest. And so more and more, if you pay attention, you can see these Jesuit priests standing with the members of Congress. Mitt Romney is listing potential running mates, and he chooses Catholic Jeb Bush. And this is what he said about Catholic Jeb Bush. "I love him. If his name weren't Bush, he'd be running for president, I am convinced," says Romney. More proof that the Roman Catholic Church is Babylon. The Roman Catholic Cardinal falls blessing Easter baskets. The AP article, April 8, 2007. He slipped and fell on the marble floor of a church while blessing Easter baskets. Remember Ishtar, the Queen of Babylon? And here we have the Roman Catholic Church blessing Ishtar, which is the Queen of Babylon. There's your another connection right there. This is dated March 24, 2007, marked the 50th anniversary of signing of the Treaty of Rome, a major step towards the creation of today's European Union. And look who's given the address, the Pontiff, Pope, told the bishops in Rome for the ceremonies, then they're here celebrating the Roman Empire. It's the same connections that's happened all the way up through the ages, where the pontiff and the kings of Europe and now the kings of the world are all joining hands in this great new Babylonian New World Order. This article is out of the UK, dated January 21st, 2007. Saddam's lieutenant pleads to Pope for mercy. Aziz, that's him right here, the former deputy prime minister of Iraq, has thrown himself on the mercy of the Pope in an attempt to secure his release from the U.S. custody. And here you see that what's very interesting is he's a 70-year-old Catholic. Isn't this very interesting? And as you read on in the article, look at this. Aziz is a Chaldean Catholic from a Babylonian branch of the church, which maintained full ties with Rome. Isn't that interesting that he's a Chaldean Catholic, and we know that the crypto Jew is another branch of full ties with Rome, so we see these different races of people that call themselves by different names that are in full ties with Rome. So everything is one big Babylonian New World Order system. This is dated September 24, 2006. The headline is Europe blasted for not defending the Pope. The president of the European Commission has expressed disappointment that European leaders have failed to defend the Pope Benedict over his recent remarks about Islam. And he goes on, we must defend our values. See, it's interesting how the kings of Europe are defending the Pope like they've done in the past. And you see it now, it's in the future, or today's time frame. Here's an Associated Press article, November 5th, 2006. The first Catholic cathedral in the U.S. reopens. It goes on, Baltimore, the first Roman Catholic cathedral in the United States, reopened to the public Saturday at $34 million restoration. The St. Peter's is to the Universal Church, the Baltimore Basilica. See, the Universal Church, a worldwide symbol of religious freedom. And it goes on to say here that the 200-year-old cathedral came to symbolize the acceptance of Catholicism in the fledging United States. So here they're talking about the acceptance that the church has received, but at a period of time it was not received. So now it's a universal church of all religions called Babylon. You see books like this all the time, Historic America, the Southwest. And on the front cover, you can't help but the Catholic missions. And if you look at the Western shows, they're all over the place. And people got to understand that these Jesuits are like insects. The Catholic Church is everywhere to open up schools, to indoctrinate the Indians, to indoctrinate the Mexicans. That's why they call it Latin America, folks, because that's where it came from, is Latin. And Latin, the only language that is officially Latin, if you look it up in your encyclopedia, is the Vatican. It's the only place that has Latin as the official language of their state. Anyway, it's all interesting when you connect the dots. Here's another old photograph right here of the Jesuits' school system and their mission, training and indoctrinating the people of the Indian race and the Mexican race. And there's just another building there of a mission. Of course, this is the famous Alamo in San Antonio, Texas. And a lot of people don't understand that this was a Catholic mission. And so here again, we have these symbolic buildings that have historical background. That's a Catholic mission and a school system. Out of this same book, on page 71, in 1823, Austin established San Felipe de Austin to serve as the colonial capital of Texas. As an American settler is poured into Texas, they set up their own communities, quickly outnumbering Hispanic settlers. Most refuse to become Mexican citizens, convert to Roman Catholicism, or learn Spanish, all of which had been conditions accepted by Austin. So here, in order to become a Mexican citizen, you had to convert to Roman Catholicism. So if you're a Protestant, there's absolutely no way you can, would convert to a Roman. See the stronghold people that, how many people know this? That in order to become a Mexican citizen, you had to give up your Christian beliefs as a Protestant and become a Roman Catholic, be part of the Roman Catholicism, and learn Spanish. It sounds like today, doesn't it? And learn Spanish. Try to go down to Mexico and try to tell him to learn English. Yeah, this news article is September 21st, 2006, WorldNet Daily. The Iranian president talks to the United Nations, and he reveals an apocalyptic view. And listen to what the Iranian president said, that a messianic figure is posed to reveal himself after an apocalyptic holocaust on the earth that leaves most of the world's population dead. Here he is. He's saying that a messianic figure is posed to reveal himself after World War III. And right after he gave this speech at the UN, he went over to the Council of Foreign Relations building in New York and spent 90 minutes with the CFR in meetings. Now, this is very revealing that they're all in bed together. Of course, the UN chief in his last speech says global war over religion. You see how it's all over religion? This is an interesting article out of Wikipedia, the free encyclopedia online. Type in prophecy of the popes. And here you read the prophecy of the popes attributed to Saint Malachy. And he lists 112 short phrases in Latin, the next 112 popes from the time he had these trances. He went into a trance and he had these revelations. And as you look and see, flip the page, you see here, he has the different popes, 167, 68, and here he has Latin, and here it is in English. And you can see as you flip through all of the different revelations he had all the way up to the very last pope. And we're going to get to it here in a second. There's quite a few. And right here, on this side here, you got the 111th pope. And here it is in French, in Latin. And here is Benedict. And so basically, he was correct on all his prophecies from the 110th. As you see up here, as the 110th Pope, John Paul II, then he reveals that Benedict would be the 111th. And now he only says there's one more after this, and this is the 112th Pope. And this Pope is going to be called Pope Peter. And it says the Holy Roman Church will be occupied by Peter the Roman. And so like they say that Peter was the first Pope, and it will end. The first shall be last, and last shall be first. And that the next pope will be called Peter. Now we're going to speculate and find out who I believe is going to be the next pope. And this is the guy that is the personal secretary of the pope right now. His name is Don George Gangswine. And I'll get into more of that. This is who I believe the last pope will be, is Don George Gangswine. And he is the private secretary of the current Pope, Pope Benedict. And Pope Benedict was the private secretary of the previous Pope. And so here we see the chain of command. Now, they keep this individual completely out of the spotlight. But you can see a few pictures and stuff on the internet if you look him up. Here is one of the few pictures you can find online. This is George Gangswine. And there's the Pope. And we're going to read a little article right here of what the Guardian has to say about him. This is reported on Tuesday, August 23rd, 2005. And it says right here that George Gangswine is the poster boy of Catholic conservatism. The Italian press compares him to what? George Clooney. And we'll get a nice little shot of that so you can see it. See, the Italian press compares him to George Clooney and who else? And Hugh Grant. Here he is, the poster boy of Catholic conservatism. And here he is, up here, is the poster boy of what I believe is the final and last pope called Pope Peter. And in the same article, listen to what the one German magazine remarked. We women held our breath. And it goes on, shame that he is taboo for us women. Well, when you have all the looks of George Clooney and Hugh Grant, you're going to get a huge following of the women. The article goes on and says that he's a doctor of canon law. He's gotten his PhD degree. Same article goes on to say that he understands complicated issues within about 10 seconds and can give a clear and immediate answer. He's very eloquent and can be very charming. So not only does he have that he can solve complicated issues within 10 seconds, but he's very eloquent and can be very charming, exactly what the world would love to see in a leader. Again, this article is titled, Thou Shall Not Drool, and it's August 23rd, 2005, The Guardian, and this is where you can find this article I just read to you. This is really big news. This is concerning the Black Pope, Peter Hans Kovenbach. We'll take a nice close look at him. He's the current general of the Jesuits, the most powerful man in the world, and look what this says here in the Catholic News Press. Says the Jesuits to elect new black pope in 2008. It would begin on January 5th, 2008 in Rome. Each of the 91 provinces in the world will hold a provincial congregation by March 1st, 2007 to prepare for the Rome's gathering. And then he's going to be prepared to step down in 2008, so we need to keep a close eye on who the new general is going to be. This is out of the same article. It says, Kovenbach is never seen without his black, and you read over here, cassock. So he's always wearing black. And here's the website you can find it at, catholicnews.com. He's been the general since 1983, and it's unlike generals that they always die in office. That's when they're replaced. So this is a monumental event that's going to happen. And so why are they going to put a new black into office in 2008? Because I believe they have something big planned for us coming here in 2008 or soon after. The Illuminati Jesuits want you to blame the Jews for everything. And the Lord knew this, and that's why it says in Scripture, the opposite is true, Isaiah 5 verse 20. Says the opposite is true. The Jesuit military uses Jews as a cover known as crypto Jews. And in Revelation chapter 2, verse 9, quote, I know the blasphemy of them which say they are the Jews and are not, but are the synagogue church of Satan. The Jews did not have the power to kill Christ. The Jews had to go to Rome, i.e. Pilate, and nothing has changed. So, see, the Jews, they didn't have the power to kill Christ, and so they had to go to Pilate, i.e. Rome, because Rome has the power to kill and to punish their government. And right here, Daniel confirms that nothing will change, Daniel chapter 2, verse 37 through 44, because he saw this Roman Empire will rule until Christ's kingdom comes and destroys it. So nothing has changed throughout history as far as the power structure, and when we need permission, we have to go to Rome to attack one country or the next, just like the Jews had to go to Rome to kill Christ. Nothing has changed, just like Daniel says. And in the article, it goes on to says, it says, Rome hides behind the cloth of the church and has always killed the Jews and uses them as bait. The Jesuits of the short robe take on Jewish names as a cover, and or the Jews who swore an allegiance to Rome are called crypto Jews. So everyone will be blamed on everything on them so they can turn around and kill the real Jews. And it says here, it's called the Hegelian dialectic process. Create the crisis, control both sides, then offer the solution, order out of chaos. Rome is hiding behind the synagogue church in disguise, and their goal is to round up all the real Jews and blame them for everything and kill them all, so the Lord will have none of his people to come home to. Also, Rome's goal is to blame the Esau Arabs for everything. For example, 9/11, to kill them all. Both Jews and Arabs will want peace, so they will clamor to have the Roman Pope to sit in the Temple Mount. So here we got the three groups of people that always wanted to control Israel or Jerusalem. It's always been the Jews and the Arabs. That's what you see on the news all the time, these two factions fighting over the Temple Mount. But what's hiding in the wings is the Roman Church. Remember, they controlled that part of the world, the Temple Mount, for about 180 years, and then they were ran out by the Arabs. But here, the Jesuits are having the Jews and the Arabs fight among each other, so they can't stand each other, and they want peace. And who are they going to go to for peace? Is the third party, the Roman Pope. And this is what's going to happen in the future to who's going to be able to occupy Solomon's rebuilt temple. Nothing has changed throughout history that these three groups all wanted to control Jerusalem. It's called the Hegelian dialectic process. Rome will come out on top for a period of 3.5 years. Then the Lord will wreck Rome's plan and finally destroy the Holy Roman Empire called the Fourth Reich. You need to study the history of the Dark Middle Ages to connect these dots. When Rome captured Jerusalem in the Middle Ages, they like to put their sun symbol of Baal on top of the Dome of the Rock and here to occupy the holy site of Solomon's temple. And thus they have the sun symbol, which represents sun day. And when Islam, the Arabs, kicked out the Catholic control of the Temple Mount, they put up their insignia. It's the representation of the moon. Thus we have moon day, Monday, moon day. So we have Sunday with the cross, Sunday, and then we have moon day. And so it's a battle over the Baal worship of Monday, Tuesday. They're all representation of the different pagan astrology planets and that every day of the week. It all goes back to Babylon. Okay, four things are going to come out of World War III. These four kingdoms will be destroyed. First kingdom is going to be USA and America. They're going to be one entity destroyed. And then you got the Middle East and Arabs is on the hit list of destruction. Then the Temple Mount is going to be destroyed, and the true followers of Israel will go into the Petras like they did in the Old Testaments to flee from the wickedness. And then you also, the Vatican is going to be destroyed. Now the people of the world will feel badly for the Vatican is completely destroyed. And so the world will also clamor that the Vatican's purpose is to move to Jerusalem, the new Jerusalem, and rebuild Solomon's temple. And then so the Pope is going to have the Arabs and Israel fight, and then out of this Hegelian dialectic will come the Vatican third party, which these two will clamor to sit in the rebuilt Solomon's temple. And here we're going to have the New World Order. It's going to be the headquarters. The New Jerusalem is going to be the headquarters of the New World Order, the Jesuit New World Order. I thought this was a good cartoon out of the newspaper, September 25th, 2006. Let me quote an ancient text to judge not that ye be not judged. And this is Pope Benedict here over the critical comments of Islam, because they want to start this war on religions, World War III. And it's interesting, this cartoonist had the Spanish Inquisition, and he has his eyes closed, the Pope. And then it has the Holocaust in action, and here you have the Pope's ears being closed off. And then you have the pedophilia silence. And here you have what's going on in the church with his mouth covered. And here you see the atrocities throughout the ages as a continuation of what's going on now. And this was in the Daily Herald, Monday, September 25th, 2006. This is kind of a funny cartoon because 99% of the people are like these people right here. And this guy is warning the end is being completely ignored. Here's another cartoon. Here's the Pope adding gasoline to Islam bigotry. And it's funny, you know, adding fuel. And so you can see here he is at the Bell Cross, and he's adding gasoline. And here we have cartoons telling us what's going on. I want to take you through this book I picked up called Washington from the Air. Let's take a look at Washington, D.C. This is out of White Star Publishers. It's one of the first pictures they have on in their book. This is the obelisk called Washington Monument. This is a symbol of Babylon, or Nimrod. That's why it has the rod Nimrod. It's the male phallus. This is a symbol of Baal, the sun god. You have to go back and read the transcripts of ancient Babylon, where you had Queen Semiramis, and she was impregnated by Nimrod, and that's why they have this symbol here. It's a Babylonian symbol. How Christian is this? This is going across the bridges into Washington, D.C. Here they have the Greek idols here, all in nude. How would you like to have your children in that see this as they're entering into Washington, D.C.? Obviously, Satan likes to incorporate each one of the kingdoms into one, the Greek kingdom into the Roman Empire kingdom, and so they incorporate all these old New World Order kingdoms into the next New World Order kingdom up. That's why you have all these symbolisms of paganism and nudity and Easter with fertility with the eggs and the rabbits and everything like that. What kind of message is this sending to your children? And here on page 24, it says, white temples of Greek and Roman. Where is the temple of God? It's always these pagan religious temples that they build there in Washington, D.C. This is a symbol. This is the Washington Capitol right here. This is a drawing in 1874. And look at here. Here's the Bohemian Owl. There's the eyes. There's the body of the owl. And he's standing on top of the Pyramid Roads, which we'll show you another picture of. But there's the White House and the body of the owl of Bohemian. Here's a photograph on page 43. And here you see the Bohemian Owl. There's the eyes, there's the Capitol, there's the body, and there's the Pyramid Road that this Bohemian Owl is standing on. This picture was taken in 1939 picture. And there's the White House and the Bohemian Owl and the Pyramid Road. Here in the book, page 76, here you see the emblems of the naked man and woman on the horseback crossing the bridge into Washington. And over here looks like horses with wings on both sides, which is both the pagan Greek Roman idols. And here's another view right there. And there is a back view of those horsemen. And here you see the bridges leading into Washington, D.C., and there's those Greek idols. And here's those horses with wings going into the bridges going across. Then you know you're entering into Babylon. Let's see the churches they have in this book. This one is St. Peter's Cathedral right here. This one here is the Church of St. Peter's is the shortest walk from Capitol Hill of the Church of Rome. Anyway, they all meet in here, go into the confessional booths, and then they get their orders behind closed doors. How convenient disguise. Here's another photograph of a church. Lo and behold, it's a Catholic shrine again. And here you see it, right there. And we flip it over to this, and there's a close-up. Looks like the Dome of the Rock, doesn't it? And again, look what we got here, the National Cathedral. Took 90 years to build. There's the center place of Babylon. And in between the Catholic churches in Washington, what do we got? The Roman Colosseum. We got to keep the people entertained through theater and other means to keep them distracted off God's word, the Bible. And here we have the different Catholics and Protestants all worshiping the games like they did back in Rome when Rome was on fire and nobody paid attention until it was all destroyed. Oh, and besides the churches, look what else we got. We got a college in Washington, D.C. called Georgetown University. It's a Jesuit-run and operated college. How convenient that Bill Clinton went there and was trained by the Jesuits. This kind of sounds like the Vatican. Listen to this. Georgetown is a small city within a larger city. It's like the Vatican is a small city within Rome. Boy, this is really nice. This is Georgetown's fame. It includes a rather dark attraction. The film The Exorcist was filmed here at Georgetown University. Some say that Jesuit Georgetown University, which is the oldest university in the Jesuit-controlled university in America, and here it says Here it says, founded in 1789, Georgetown University is the oldest Catholic university in the United States. It has been run by the Jesuits since 1805. So now you know I'm not making this stuff up. It's all run by the Jesuits, where Bill Clinton went to school. There's a photograph of the old quad, the old part of Jesuit University, right there. Is that it on? So there you have it, Washington from the air. So now you see that there's hardly any mention, or there's no mention of any Protestants at all in Washington, D.C., but it's all about Catholic churches and Catholic schools. Anyway, isn't that very interesting? Hello, my name is Dave Cleveland. I'm the one that's been running things behind the scene. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you make copies and spread the word out. May God bless you. Thank you.
In concrete, in eternity.